All right. Tell you where we've been. Oh, the bell. I got the official timepiece. But 3 weeks ago, we looked at the miracle of Jesus' birth. And to repeat the statement from Wayne Grudem, a theologian, a statement I love, I read it to you last week, the fact that the infinite, omnipotent, eternal Son of God could become man and join himself to a human nature forever, so that infinite God became one person with finite man, will remain for eternity the most profound miracle and the most profound mystery in all the universe. So we looked at the incarnation, touched the hem of the garment, the birth of Jesus, and that was 3 weeks ago. Then 2 weeks ago, we looked at aspects of Jesus' ministry prior to his crucifixion. I mean, the crucifixion is really the crowning achievement of his ministry. So we looked up to that, and we saw there his announcement. His ministry was his announcement of the good news, the great news of the kingdom's arrival. And we saw that he taught about the nature and the character of the kingdom of God and corrected some misconceptions that existed about that. He taught about the ethics of the kingdom, how we are to live as kingdom participants. He taught about that, and he demonstrated or previewed aspects of the kingdom in the miracles that he did, the raising of the dead people, the exorcisms that he did. And we saw that he also trained the apostles. And then last week, we focused on Jesus' extraordinary nature. Jesus is a man, but he's no ordinary man. And we looked at that, and we saw that his extraordinary nature is evident in the things that he said. And in that regard, we looked at the parable of the bridegroom in their midst, the comparison to Jonah and Solomon, the sermon in the synagogue in Nazareth, his conversation with the woman at the well, the statement that he made when he was on trial. We looked at his statement where he says, "Before Abraham was, I am." His claim in John 14:6 to be the exclusive path to the Father, and his call that he made on people to unrivaled loyalty. So this is evident in the things that he said, but we all saw it's also evident in things that he did. His extraordinary nature is evident there as well. And we saw that in his accepting worship from people without rebuke, without, don't do that. He received that. We saw it in his forgiving of sins, and we saw it in his performing great miracles. Now, the assigned topic for this morning is Son of God. Now, I have to say again that I wasn't entirely sure what I was expected to teach under this title, given what I've said in previous weeks, given what I've said about the incarnation, the ministry of Jesus, that he's no ordinary man, and then here's a title, Son of God. So I wasn't quite sure what I'm to teach here, but I'm going to explore the phrase Son of God. And then toward the end of the class, I want to look at two other titles, Messiah/Christ and Son of Man. So I hope that there'll be something of value to you in here. Now, the phrase Son of God, that can refer to different relationships with God. In other words, it need not mean by itself that the being referred to as a Son of God is divine, is God, is worthy of worship. It need not mean that. You see, for example, in the genealogy in Luke chapter 3, it ends up where Adam is described there as the Son of God. Now, he's the Son of God in distinction from the others who are listed in the genealogy, in that God is his direct creator. You see, Adam has no human parents, no intermediate human causes of his existence, but he's clearly a man. I mean, right? I mean, Adam, he's clearly a man. He's the first man. He's a human being. Now, he's made in the likeness and image of God, but he is not God. He is not divine in nature. He is not someone that we could worship. That's only something for God. So here we have one, clearly a human being, but called the Son of God. Angels are sometimes referred to as sons of God. And you see that most clearly in a number of texts in Job, in 1:6, 2:1, 38:7. And you also see it in texts like Psalm 29:1 and Psalm 89:6, but you might not know it there because usually the phrase sons of God is there translated as heavenly beings. Now they just are going, that's what it means. And so translators will typically just go ahead and supply that for you so you don't get confused about it. But you see it there as heavenly beings typically. But angels are not divine. They're spiritual beings. They're not divine. They're beings who are created by God. Creatures. Spiritual creatures, but they're creatures. You see that in Nehemiah 9:6, Psalm 148, verses 2 to 5. John 1, 1-3, Colossians 1:15 and 16, and no doubt elsewhere. Angels are not divine. Angels are not God. They are called sons of God, but that doesn't carry the connotation in their context that they are God. And so you see that, you know. They're similar to God in certain ways, but they are not divine. They are not worthy of worship. And you recall in Revelation 19, 9 and 10, 22, 8, and 9, when John falls down to worship an angel, and what's that angel say? Whoa. Mm-mm. No worship of me. I'm just a fellow servant. Worship God. Only God is to be worshiped. Angels are not divine, therefore they cannot receive worship, and they don't. And yet we see they're referred to as sons of God. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 9, Jesus says there, he says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. And here the phrase is a reflection. See, there it's a reflection of God's character that is in view. So see, they're called sons of God because they are reflecting, they're emulating God. They are reflecting His character. Those who are reconcilers, agents of healing in this world of fragmentation, they are mirrors of God. You see, they have a family resemblance. The apple doesn't fall far from the tree, is how we would say it. So here when he says in Matthew 5, 9, blessed are the peacemakers, they shall be called sons of God. They are acting and reflecting God's character. They are not divine in nature, they're human beings, right? They're people. But they're still, the title is applied there, sons of God. And you see that same sense in Luke chapter 6, verse 35. But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return, and your reward will be great. And you will be sons of the Most High, for He is kind to the ungrateful and the evil. See, in imitating God, one is acting like a son. One is following in the Father's footsteps, emulating the Father. That's how sons and fathers were in the ancient world. You see, the son would go off and he would imitate his father. He would go into his father's business. His father's a carpenter. His father would teach the son about carpentry. The son would become a carpenter. And so he would emulate the father. And that's the sense of Son of God that's being used here. And of course, the ultimate imitating of God will come at the consummation when our sanctification is completed and we are like Christ, thus like God in a fuller and more complete way. And that's what's behind Revelation chapter 21. You really see 6 and 7. But here in 7 it says, the one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. Well, it is in the completeness of sanctification that we are mirrors or reflections of God in the fullest sense. And so you see that idea picked up there. Now you also see sons of God in 2 Samuel 7, 13 and 14. There, the Davidic king, okay, the Davidic king, that's the descendant of David who carries on the ruling dynasty. Here he's referring to Solomon. But there you see the Davidic king is referred to as a son of God. Now the king is not divine in nature. Nobody's fallen down worshiping the king. I mean, only God is worshiped. And yet he's called son of God here because he occupies the office through which God's reign over the people of Israel is to be reflected. You see, he's son of God in that sense. The king is to rule as an expression of God's rule, which includes showing God's passion for justice. This is how he's to be. He's to be God there in that sense on the throne. His passion for justice, his commitment to the covenant, his hatred of idolatry and his concern for the oppressed. He's God's son in terms of his calling. Now, did the kings always live up to that? No. I hope you've been here enough and seen enough in the flow of history. But his calling and his office and what he was to be as a reflection of God's reigning through him. He's son of God in that sense. And covenant people, those who put their trust in God, they are sometimes called sons of God. You see, for example, Deuteronomy 14:1, the first part of that verse, Moses tells the Israelites, you are sons of the Lord your God. And you see in Galatians 3:26, Paul tells the Galatian Christians, for in Christ Jesus, you're all sons of God through faith. So what I'm doing is I'm trying to show you there are senses of son of God and sons of God that don't have connotations that the being to which that title is applied, that being is divine, is God. So there are clearly senses in which that's true, that a connotation of divinity is not inherent in the phrase son of God. In terms of covenant participants, son, it's used to designate a special relationship, a closeness or a bond. You see, that exists between God and his covenant people. God loves all people. But there is a closeness and a bond between God and his covenant people as a father with a son. And that's what's being designated. It's not intended to convey that covenant participants are divine and that therefore it's acceptable to fall down and worship your brothers and sisters in Christ. It doesn't have that connotation in that context. Now, some of the references to Jesus as Son of God, they could be taken in one of these senses that don't have a connotation of divinity. Some of the references to Jesus as Son of God could be taken in those senses that lack divine connotation, senses that need not mean he is in nature God. He's the ultimate Davidic king, for example. Right? He is the ultimate son of David. And thus, like other Davidic kings before him, he could be the son of God in terms of his office and calling, not necessarily in terms of his nature. So you see that. Now, he's also sinless, right? So he is sinless. And thus, he's one who perfectly reflects God's being and God's character in this world. So he could be seen as son of God in that more limited sense. That he's a mirror of God. He's an expression of God. Not necessarily is he divine in nature. Okay? But there are uses of son of God in reference to Jesus that cannot be so confined. You see, there are uses that cannot be so confined and that show his uniqueness. He is a son like no other. And they show his uniqueness and thereby they indicate, you see, his divine nature. I'll run through some of these, in fact, maybe more than you want to see. And once that sense, you see, once that sense of Son of God as applied to Jesus becomes clear, well, then the more ambiguous uses applied to Jesus take on a different light. And see, there are a couple of mistakes I think people make with this. They say, well, look, you can see that Son of God need not carry connotations of divinity, therefore it does not in Christ's case. No, that's not necessarily true. Yes, I see that it need not, but we'll see that it can and does in the context of Jesus. So you have people who go at it from that side. And then some people will say, well, no, you see, Jesus is Son of God and Jesus is divine. Therefore, every other use when it says Son of God, they too are divine. So you're gods and that. No, that's not true either. You see, and this is just the way language is. And you have to get down and say, okay, are there uses and senses that are unique to Jesus so that Son of God in his context is now invested with notions of divinity? Where it's not in these other contexts, and some about Christ you could say are ambiguous, can we see the phrase Son of God in his context applied to him where it does in fact carry notions of divinity? And what I'm suggesting to you is that it does. It does. Now we read in John chapter 1, I read this a few weeks ago, but in John chapter 1, verse 1 and 2, and then skip down to 14, read it all, it's all wonderful. But it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. Now I underline this, all things were made through Him. That's pretty pretty powerful assertion. You're beginning to think beyond creature, right? I mean, all things were made through Him. This is Son as Creator. Well, that's an attribute of whom? God. You see, God. And he says, and without him was not anything made that was made. Everything that is made was made through him. And he says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son. Well, are there sons of God? Yeah, they're sons of God. In different senses, different connotations. But there is a sense in which he's the only Son of God from the Father, full of grace and truth. This uniqueness, the fact that he's the only Son. You see, so there's something distinctive about Son of God when applied to him because he's unique. He's the only Son. And you see this uniqueness, the fact he's the only Son. It's repeated in several other places, all of which you're very familiar with. John 3:16 through 18. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son? Well, aren't we sons of God by faith in Christ? Well, yeah, we are. Yes. But do you see that you just can't go rigidly and say, okay, Son of God, language, come over here, Son of God, means same everywhere. Okay? It's more involved than that. He's the only Son. He goes on, whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him, whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. You see in 1 John 4:9, in this the love of God was manifested among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. Uniqueness. There is something about Christ's sonship that is unique. In John 5:22, you start to get a hint. What is the uniqueness? Well, there are a number of things. What I want you to see is that one of these things about uniqueness, why he's the only Son, is that he is God. He is divine in nature. The Father judges no one, but has given all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Now, what creature do you hear of that? That all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Who's getting honor just as that which the Father gets? Well, do you see? This is something that is only to be given God. And so you see, whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. John 17, 1 to 5, Jesus prays, he says, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you, since you've given him authority over all flesh to give eternal life to all whom you've given him. And this is eternal life, that they know you are the only true God and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Do you see a distinction? You're all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. But who creates all things? Who is there with God before the world existed? You see, Son of God applied to Jesus takes on a different sense. The writer of Hebrews, in Hebrews chapter 1:1-4, having long ago spoken to the fathers many times and in many ways by the prophets, in these last days God spoke to us by the Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the universe. That's pretty, you know, that's why when I get people, you know, I like all the great religious people, you know. I like Buddha, I like Muhammad, all this. I like Jesus, you know, all the great religious thinkers. Say, look, Jesus is in a class by himself. Do you see? He's in a class by himself. So don't lump him in here with these people, with mere humans. He's man. But as we said last week, he's no ordinary man. Through whom also he made the universe, who being the radiance of the glory and the exact representation of his nature, and sustaining all things by the word of his power, Why does this place not just disintegrate? He sustains all things by the word of his power. Do you see deity? Do you see divinity? Do you see God? He says, after providing purifications of the sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven, having become as much greater than the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. Paul writes in Colossians 1:13-20, he rescued us from the dominion of the darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He, the Son, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for by him all the things in the heavens and on the earth were created. This is Jesus. You see, this is the Son. He says, the visible and the invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he's the head of the body of the church. He's the beginning of the firstborn from the dead, so that in everything he might have first place. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things in heaven or things on earth, by making peace through the blood of his cross. He is the ultimate reconciler. So not only is he creator, not only are all of these things in the heavens and on the earth were created, but he is the means by which all fragmentation and brokenness will be resolved. He is the ultimate healer of all things. He is the agent of God's reconciliation of all things. So this is now, I just want you to see that when it talks about, well, angels, well, they're sons of God, yes. Yes, with a different sense, different connotation. You're all sons of God through faith. Yes, yes, I know that. But there is a sense in which Jesus is Son of God distinctively. He is the only Son of God. And part of that only is that he is in fact divine. He is in fact God in the flesh. John chapter 5, verses 11 and 12. And this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. The one who has the Son has the life. The one who does not have the Son of God does not have the life. That's pretty significant. He is the criterion of life. Well, who does that sound like? I mean, the criterion of life. The Son. The Son of God. Now, you see, Satan, demons, the disciples, And the Jews, they all seem to get it. They all seem to recognize that Son of God applied to Jesus, that went beyond that description or that title when applied to others. They all seem to recognize that Son of God applied to Jesus had larger connotations than when applied to others. And you can see this, for example, Satan in Matthew chapter 4, verse 3. Satan recognized that Son of God, that applied to Jesus, that implied the ability to work miracles. He says, if, meaning since. He says, since you are the Son of God, well, since that's true, then go ahead and command these stones to become loaves of bread. Now, you're all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. Can you command stones to become loaves of bread? I can't. But Satan understands that Son of God has spoken to Jesus, carries with it the implication, go ahead then. Because why? Because you're Son of God in a distinctive sense. And I know that. You see, I know that. And that's important for us to recognize. The demons, Mark chapter 8, 29, they recognize that Son of God in Jesus' case, that included the power to torment them. Here are these evil spiritual powers, and they recognize that Son of God, in the case of Christ, carries with it the power to torment them. They say, and behold, they cried out, what have you to do with us, O Son of God? Have you come here to torment us before the time? Son of God, have you come to torment us? Son of God has the power over the demons. And they recognize it and they confess it in Mark 3:11. And whenever the unclean spirits saw him, what do? They are fallen angels. What do when they see him? They fall down before him and they cried out, what? You are the Son of God. Well, yeah, I know. You're Son of God. Well, you know, you're all sons of God through faith in Christ. Angels are called sons of God. Why are they falling down saying, you are the Son of God? They're doing that because they understand that as applied to Jesus, Son of God has a different connotation. It carries with it the sense that he is divine. You see, he is God. The disciples in Matthew 14, 33, we looked at this last week. They worshiped Jesus as the Son of God, and those in the boat worshiped him saying, truly, you are the Son of God. Well, if that doesn't carry the sense of divinity, why are you worshiping him? Well, we're worshiping him because in his case, Son of God does in fact carry the connotation of divinity. It carries the sense of divinity. He is God. And you can see that a couple weeks ago we went through and I listed the texts where he's just flat out called God. I think there are 8 of them. But here I'm looking at the phrase Son of God, and I'm really trying to get at this sense where I want you to see that there are senses where it is not, doesn't carry connotations of divinity, but that doesn't mean then you can't jump from that and then say, well, see, Son of God applied to Jesus doesn't carry connotations of divinity. Not necessarily so. You know, these things are, language is fluid and phrases can mean different things in different contexts. And by the same sense, because in Jesus' context, it carries connotations of divinity, that doesn't mean that I can then jump from that and say, when it says that you're all sons of God, faith in Christ, you're gods. In nature, you are divine in nature, worthy of worship and all that kind of stuff. You have all of God's powers. You can speak things into existence like God can. That's nonsense. But it comes from, a rigid kind of mechanical application that is not the way you're to think about things. You have to work through some of these things and see, okay, I can see there are senses when it's not. That's when it's applied to us. I see there are senses when it's not. That's when it's applied to the only Son. And these things have bigger implications as you spread out in theology world. And you'll see where people miss some of these things. John 19:7. In John 19:7, You see, there the Jews, they accused Jesus before Pilate. And they say, we have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God. He ought to die. He's got to die because he made himself the Son of God. You see, they understood that the phrase Son of God applied to him as he was using it, that it included a claim of deity, which was blasphemous for somebody who in their judgment is a mere human being. That's why he has to die, because he claims, he says here, he made himself the Son of God. Well, it's blasphemous. Why is it blasphemous? So that he deserves to die. Because he's a mere human being, and in saying Son of God, what he means is that he's equal with God. He's one with God in nature. He is claiming to be God. And therefore, it's blasphemous for a man to say that. Now, you see that. You see it, I think, clearly in the next verse in 5:17 and 18, which is before John 19:7. Jesus answered them, my Father, sonship, my Father is working until now, and I'm working. This was why the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. You see, that's the very same idea that is reflected in 19:7. They understood he has to die because he's made himself the Son of God. Well, what do you mean, Son of God? I mean, he's making himself equal with God. He means Son of God, not in a sense applied to angels, not in a sense applied to people of faith and covenant people. He means he is in nature God. Different. Okay, only Son of God. Okay, only Son of God. In what ways? Certainly in the sense here that he is divine. All right, so I want you to see that. I didn't know what to really to talk about on Son of God, but I wanted to say those things. So that's how it works sometimes. When I don't really see what I'm supposed to do, I just tell you what I want to say. But I also want to say a little bit about two other titles that Jesus uses and that are used of him. The first is Messiah/Christ. Then I want to say a little bit about Son of Man. Now, the Hebrew term, which in English is Messiah, and its equivalent Greek term, which in English is Christ, these are equivalent terms. They both mean anointed one. Okay, so Messiah is derived from Hebrew. Christ is derived from Greek. But the meaning of both is anointed one. And in Jewish religion and Jewish culture, that term Messiah, that term Christ, it referred to the special servant of God, the one who was specially anointed, the special servant of God who would bring about God's ultimate design for the world. He was the ultimate servant. Kings were anointed, you know, when they would come in and they would take rule. You have different people anointed. It's a sign of this is God's selection of you. But this one, this capital A anointed one, he was the servant of God who is going to bring about God's ultimate design for the world. Now, he's the one who's alluded to in the text of Isaiah 61 that Jesus read in the synagogue in Nazareth. Do you remember, I think it was last week? Is it Luke? Luke 4? Well, he's in the synagogue, and he looks in the scroll and goes down. He reads out of Isaiah 61. You know, free the oppressed and all those things. He's anointed me. And then he rolls it up and says, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. That's the anointed one. You see, that's the one. Now, during his ministry, Jesus used this title, Messiah, Christ, but he seemed to keep this on the down low. He seemed to keep it on the down low. As I reminded you last week, he said in private, in his discussion with the woman at the well, she says, I know that when Messiah comes, he'll explain all things to us. And in John 4:26, Jesus says, I who speak to you am he. You see, so he didn't deny the title at all. But he didn't really publicize it. He seemed to keep it on the down low. When Peter confessed Jesus as the Christ in-house. In Matthew 16:13-20 and the parallels in Mark 8 and Luke 9, Jesus acknowledged the truth of that statement, but he tells the disciples not to tell anybody he's the Christ. He says, you're the Christ. He says, that's right. You know, God revealed this to you, but you know, don't go publicizing that. Don't go publicizing it. And his reluctancy to wave that banner before the general public, that reluctance was tied to the false ideas that were wrapped around the Messiah. There were all of these ideas wrapped around the Messiah. See, many Jews believed that the Messiah would be God's agent for expelling Rome from Palestine by military force. This was how they perceived the Messiah, that he would bring in this ultimate golden age through military force that would begin by expelling the pagans from the Holy Land. And so in their views, he was seen as a political revolutionary. That was a common concept. So making that title one's public identification, that would have been understood in many quarters as a call for revolution and war, which would have hindered Jesus' ministry and would have brought an immediate confrontation with Rome. If Jesus wraps himself in the public banner of I am the Messiah, given all the stuff that's wrapped up with that concept, if he became too tightly identified with that publicly, well, then it would hinder his ministry because Rome is coming for him. Now, he's going to give himself to Rome, but he's going to do it in his time. And so you see this reluctance there. As I said last week, that's what's behind, you know, that careful response to Caiaphas's question in Matthew 26:63, where he says, yes, he's put under oath and he says, yes, he is the Messiah, but he does so in a way that indicated that the yes needed some qualification in light of the expectations that had grown up around. He didn't want to just say yes, given the baggage that was around that, but he couldn't say no because he is the Messiah. So he, in essence, says yes, but. You see, he says yes, but when he says you have said so. See, that's the connotation, that's the sense there of what he's saying. But that is that his answer was yes, even if yes, but. It's clear not only from the summary of the answer that's given in Mark 14:62, where he just says, I am. But there's a summary of the answer. He says, tell us, are you the Christ, the Son of God? I charge you under oath. Yeah, you got it. So you see that clearly the summary of that is given in Mark 14:62, but you also see it from the fact he was mocked during his trial and crucifixion for having claimed to be the Messiah. And you can see that in Mark 15:18-32, Luke 23:35-39. And from the fact that the charge that was nailed over his head by Pilate was what? King of the Jews. Okay, so clearly something's happened, right? This idea, you see that the yes is not only there in what he's saying, as made clear by Mark, but you see it in these other things that he's mocked for having claimed to be the Messiah. And so, you see, that shows how explosive that phrase was, right? And he would put that over as a title of the charge, King of the Jews. So you see the Lord's wisdom in that this was something that in that social environment was very explosive and had to be handled with great wisdom. Because who's running the show? The Lord is. You see, the Lord is running the show. And so he has this all done. And he has this, so he, yes, he's the Messiah, but that's not one of the phrases that he wrapped himself in publicly. Now, the phrase Son of Man, that's his favorite self-designation. Do we have Son of God, Messiah slash Christ? Now, let me say a word about Son of Man, then the bell will ring. Now, his most frequent designation is Son of Man. He refers to himself that way over 80 times in the Gospels. Now, of course, there's overlap in those. But in the four Gospels, over 80 times he uses that phrase, Son of Man. Now, in the Old Testament, that phrase, Son of Man, most often it was used simply in reference to a man or a human being. Or you're the son of a man. I mean, you know, that's you're the descendant of a human being. You're a person, a human being, a man. That's how it's most often used. You see that clearly, for example, in Psalms. And let me get back to the title there. You get it. You see it in Psalms 8:4, Psalm 80:17, 144:3, 146:3, and Ezekiel's addressed by God as Son of Man over 90 times. He's just called Son of Man. And it just refers to him as he's there, he's a human being. The emphasis is on his humanity. Ezekiel's mortality as over against God's supernatural greatness and power. So when God is calling Ezekiel Son of Man, he's saying, you are Son of Man distinct from me. I'm God, you're Son of Man. So most commonly, you see, what it means is simply means human being. It means man. But in Daniel chapter 7:13, the phrase Son of Man, it takes a different cast. In Daniel 7, verse 13, there in the context of the great judgment that comes when the little horn is raging against the saints, and I don't have time to go through all that. We taught Daniel before, and I see the little horn there with many commentators. I believe little horn there is represents Antichrist. But here you see in the context of the great judgment that comes when the little horn is raging against the saints, Daniel sees one like a Son of Man. Well, that's a picture of humanness, but who comes on the clouds of heaven as God is said to do. That's a picture of divinity. He sees one like a Son of Man, a mere human, but he's coming on the clouds of heaven, which is God. And so you have combined here this idea of humanness and divinity. And it's this kingdom that is consummated. This is the Messiah. And in Daniel, you see that he's given by God the Father an eternal and a universal kingdom. And this is the kingdom that's consummated, that comes to full expression in conjunction with the final judgment, as in an end, is inherited by the saints. You see that in Daniel 7:22, 7:26, and 27. Now, I say this is a complicated study through Daniel. But there's something going on with the reference to Daniel as one like a Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven. And in several places, Jesus links his use of the Son of Man to the reference in Daniel 7. You see, so it's another one of these phrases, right? Son of Man. It has ambiguity. Right? A Son of Man could just, well, it's just a guy. But there are other ways and flavors to it, you see, that can be appropriated that go beyond that. And Jesus links his use of Son of Man to this use in Daniel. In Mark 14, 61, 62, for example, he answers that question whether he's the Christ. Tell us, are you the Christ? Son of the Blessed. That's the second bill? Just hang with me a second. He says, I am, and you'll see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven. Well, that's right out of Daniel. You see, so he said, yeah, there's something more. Let me read you two quotes. This is from Craig Blomberg. He says, Jesus is describing himself in that text I was just mentioning as the one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven who approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence and given authority and power over all humanity, leading to universal worship and everlasting dominion. This claim to be far more than a mere mortal is probably what elicited the verdict of blasphemy from the Jewish High Court. So you see, he uses Son of Man. So there is ambiguity to it, and I'll finish with this quote from Robert Stein, who's talking about the ambiguity and how that would have suited the Lord's purpose. It could function parable-like. That, see, he could use it and then invest it with that deeper meaning when he's teaching his disciples, but other people would be kind of grasping, what's he talking about? Here's what Stein says. The confusion surrounding the title Son of Man served Jesus well. It functioned much like a parable. To those on the inside, it revealed Jesus' messianic calling. To those on the outside, it had a riddle-like quality. To the latter, it was perhaps understood as a circumlocution, a roundabout way, or as a general reference to Jesus as a human being. Thus, it served Jesus' purpose admirably. He could use it openly without fear and yet privately explain its meaning to his disciples. I think that's close to what's going on. He uses these phrases. Anyway, Son of God, Messiah Christ, Son of Man. I'm over time. Thank you.